Last time on Hipster Ninja Reviews.
Oh God. Oh God. Oh God. I just had a dream that Michael Bay made a live Beast Wars movie. And it was snowing that day, too.
Ah! A delicious Coke!
They're people! M&M's are people!
Oh, come on, it's an homage! An homage, goddammit! Leave me alone!
Ah, nothing refreshes me like a nice Coke. Thumbs up. Yeah.
Shockingly cannibalism.
Oh God, it's snowing.
And now, the conclusion. Provided we don't get sued for this.
Just a little faster.
It's been drawn to my attention that when I originally started the trilogy, I didn't go into my usual plot summary of the source material. To be fair, I did that because you have to be totally brain dead not to know what this series is about. But considering this is Michael Bay we're talking about,
you know, the guy who decided to turn the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles into aliens.
I think a quick spoiler-free summary is in order.
The Transformers franchise follows two warring robot factions, the Autobots slash Maximals versus the Decepticons slash Predacons slash Viacons, all of whom possess the ability to change into everyday objects, vehicles, and even animals.
And, most importantly, is based on a series of children's toys! And I gotta be frank with you.
After sitting through Revenge of the Fallen, I tried to avoid this sequel like the plague.
No amount of box office success or critical praise could ever convince me to watch another slap in the face like this. But, unfortunately... Look, haven't you tortured me enough yet?
Oh no, you see...
Yeah, I know, you've done more than insult me, you've insulted my ego, blah blah blah, marooned in a sea of shame and infamy. Look, you told me all this shit last year!
Oh, forgive me. I just figured, hell, given who's in this, you'd appreciate a little Star Trek reference like that.
You don't mean...
That's exactly what I mean. Okay, let me make things simple for you. Review this movie, or I make my godchild fanfiction the plot for Transformers 4.
Godchild? Who?
Oh, someone who shares my very perverted beliefs.
Sage?
Oh, please. She makes Sage's work look like Winnie the fucking Pooh.
Hey, Mr. Critic Guy. It's me, Sora. I'm not dead after all. So I was thinking, maybe we could have Matt and Ty walk into town where they encounter Sam, Michaela, and Optimus eating Hot Pockets, then-
No, I'll do it.
Good luck, Critic. You're gonna need it.
So before my sanity gives out, let's get this over with. This is Transformers Dark of the Moon. I think I might need this.
The movie begins during the space race of the 60s, explaining how, apparently, the reason we sent people up to the moon was to find an old Autobot ship called the Argo.
Also, you gotta love how the moon seems to have normal gravity here.
After that, we cut to...
My hero needs to wake up.
some really shitty acting.
It's here where we're reintroduced to the bane of my existence, Sam Witwicky, and his new girlfriend, Carly, played by Rosie Huntington-Whiteley.
It makes Kristen Stewart look like a professional thespian, who was essentially given the job after Megan Fox was fired for calling Michael Bay a Nazi.
So they get into a boring BS conversation that can basically be summed up like this. You need to get a job.
I don't wanna.
Let's shag.
Okay.
Oh yeah. Real realistic, Bay. Top-notch writing.
We're also reintroduced to Wheelie, still voiced by Tom Kenny, and his new buddy Brains, voiced by Reno Wilson.
Great. Mini skids in Mudflap.
Also, where the hell did Brains come from? It's never really explained, and yet he plays an important part in this movie.
You can't do that, Bay. You can't just introduce an important character item without any explanation of where the hell it came from. What?
Wrong, 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 wrong. Wrong, 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 wrong.
Heard you were dealing with Michael Bay. Hope this helps, Master Ninjor. Why is it pink?
Wrong, 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 wrong.
It's not pink, it's fighting salmon. Now shut up and finish the review. Okay, moving on.
After some more shenanigans with Sam's parents that will contribute jack shit to the plot, we finally cut to a scene with the Autobots.
Because, you know, it's not like they're the reason we're watching this damn movie in the first place!
Anyways, we cut to the Autobots and Nest in Chernobyl, where they discover a strange device before being attacked by a Decepticon named Shockwave, voiced by Frank Wilker. Luckily, it's Optimus to the rescue, and he's able to drive Shockwave away. Prime then recognizes the device Nest found, and we cut back to a montage of Sam's interview failures before his inner Disney princess kicks in during an interview for a company called Accurata Systems.
Mister, I saved your life twice, okay? I can't tell you how or when or why, but I have done shit that matters, and I just kind of like a job where I matter again.
Yeah, this coming from the guy who, in the last movie, said he didn't want to get involved because, and I quote, "I just want to be a normal guy." It's called continuity, Bay! Learn to use it! Oh, and Sam's boss, Bob Barzos, is played by John Malkovich, but he contributes nothing to the plot, so moving on.
So because this movie runs on dumbass logic, Sam winds up getting the job because his boss wants to teach him humility or some crap like that.
Yeah, that makes total sense. You know, except for the fact that he's had two smoking hot girlfriends, discovered an alien race, and, oh yeah, literally came back from the dead! Let's face it, this guy wouldn't know humility if it came onto him in the bathroom!
That's why I'm not... Don't.
Whoa, no. We are not there yet.
Cut back to Nest HQ, and we're introduced to another government official, Charlotte Meering, played by Frances McDormand.
And despite being Bay's stereotypical douchebag government official, she's easily one of the more likable characters in this movie.
Stop with the ma'am. Enough with the ma'am. Do I look like a ma'am?
It's also revealed that Optimus is somewhat pissed that a piece of Autobot tech from a ship he thought was destroyed was in Chernobyl and nobody told him about it. And then we get a cameo from Dr. Buzz Aldrin, who explains how they found the Ark on the moon during the Apollo 11 mission. Optimus goes into full-on exposition mode and explains how the Ark was carrying equipment to end their war with the Decepticons and demands that they be allowed to retrieve the technology from the Ark before the Decepticons find it. Unfortunately, we then cut back to Sam visiting Carly at her work, where we're also introduced to her boss, Dylan Gold, played by Patrick Dempsey.
Really sets no purpose except to set Dylan up as a potential rival for Sam, a la a bad episode of Degrassi.
Thankfully, we cut back to the Autobots on the moon that seems to have the Earth's gravity, where they find what they were looking for. We then cut to Africa, where Megatron, still wounded from his battle with Optimus at the end of the last movie, tells Laserbeak, voiced by Keith Sarabica, that it's time to start killing off people who have apparently been helping them out. We then cut to a montage that was clearly meant for the trailer.
Is your daddy home?
Then Madeline said it's about time.
Hello, Mom.
What are you doing in my house?
visiting.
And by that, I mean uses that trailer style of editing where it constantly cuts to black.
I know it's supposed to be an intense scene, but all those awkward cuts make it really disorienting and hard to watch.
I mean, seriously, could you imagine if I conducted a review like that? Heyo! I'm the Hipster Ninja, saving fandoms, one bad adaptation at a time. It seriously looks like amateur hour, guys.
Anyways, we cut back to Sam during his first day as a mail clerk for Accurata Systems, where he bitches some more about wanting to be part of that world above, or being more to this provincial life while looking once more just around the river bend.
I don't know, he's bitching, that's all that matters.
And we cut to Sam in an elevator where we're introduced to Jerry Wang, played by...
May I finish my Xuhua milk, Donnie?
Oh, frack no!
Ugh, played by Ken Jeong, who pulls Sam into the bathroom to discuss some terms.
Don't. I'm gonna hit you.
I'm gonna hit you right back, son.
By getting naked. Ugh, goddammit.
So after that particularly scarring moment, Sam goes back to his desk and looks through some newspaper clippings that Jerry gave him. Interested, he tries to go ask him about the clippings, but is strangely turned away. It's then revealed that Laserbeak was in the room with him, and we get the most satisfying death scene ever put to film as Laserbeak pushes him out the window.
Huh? Who wants some chicken dinner now, bitch? 'Cause somebody messed with the wrong wang today!
Need any more didactic lectures from Chuck. Well, that's not helping.
Jesus!
So after that little bit of catharsis, Laserbeak proceeds to blow shit up and chase Sam, who somehow manages to outrun him, as we cut to Sam and Carly driving to Nest HQ, where Sam begins working on his Will Ferrell impression.
Do not hit my car to collector's items!
You need to be dead!
Wow!
Ladies and gentlemen, throws a tantrum like a 3-year-old.
Eventually, Bumblebee is able to fix the little misunderstanding, and Sam then proceeds to lecture him about not getting to see him anymore.
I'm sorry, the guy who last movie told Bumblebee to go off and work with the Autobots and leave him alone is now complaining about how Bumblebee has gone off to work with the Autobots and left him alone! We're not stupid, Bay! Stop treating us like we are!
So Sam brings the info to Lennox, but is essentially told to bugger off by Meering, who also threatens to throw him in jail for treason if he jeopardizes the mission. While this is going on, Optimus uses the Matrix of Leadership to resurrect Sentinel Prime.
The war! The war!
And he's voiced by Leonard Nimoy! That's awesome!
So Sentinel reveals that he had pillars on the Ark that could create a teleportation device.
No, I'm not making a Star Trek joke.
And we then follow Sam home, where he goes on bitchy rant number 1138, and then decides to call in help from...
Kid, what's he want?
I called you because the Decepticons are back, and I want to know why, and I need your help.
They're back?
So after some more disorienting trailer edits and a corny one-liner that must have been meant for the trailer...
Tell Megatron, let's tango.
We find out that the Decepticons were using humans to help hide something they found on the moon.
We also get some pointless romance scenes, but I really don't think anyone who came to see a Transformers movie cares about that.
I did.
You were saying.
Okay, I'll go.
That's what I thought. Now, where was I?
Sam Simmons and his assistant Dutch, played by Steve the Pirate.
Garf! Vader!
Then proceed to confront one of the Russian astronauts rumored to be part of this conspiracy, and it's revealed that a Russian satellite picked up images of Sentinel Prime's pillars, which leads to the revelation that the Decepticons took most of them and are after Sentinel Prime so that they can use his teleportation machine.
Everybody got that?
Unfortunately, on their way back, our heroes are all attacked by a group of Decepticons whose names I neither know nor care about. Luckily, they're able to take a few of them out before getting back to Nest, where Ironhide...
who, I'd like to point out, has about 2 days till retirement.
Along with Sideswipe, take out the other two Decepticons in a totally badass fashion.
And then something truly horrible happens. Michael Bay comes up with... clever plot twist.
Sentinel reveals that he made a deal with Megatron to end the war, and then proceeds to kill Ironhide execution style.
As much as it sickens me to say it, that was a really good sequence.
The twist, as I said, was bloody brilliant. The tension after he kills Ironhide is really damn good, and he's really built up as a badass, just walking through Ness, taking out soldiers left, right, and center.
Of course, knowing Bay, he'll just end up going out like a bitch like Megatron in The Fallen did.
Long story short, Sentinel is able to escape with the pillars just as Optimus arrives to get chewed out by Meering.
We then cut back to the worst possible thing you could cut to after a scene that heavy. Comic relief from Sam's parents.
This, she comes first, there's some killer shit in
no,
here.
No.
Oh, that's it.
I know.
Because, hey, who needs to see the characters actually reacting to Sentinel's betrayal and the death of a comrade? No. What we need is even more annoying comic relief.
I'm sorry. As stupid as Revenge of the Fallen was, at least it actually gave us some time to show how Sam, Mikaela, and Bumblebee were reacting to Optimus' death. Sure, it wasn't much, but it's more than I can say about this piece of crap. God, I can't believe I just offended that.
After that little aneurysm of a scene, Sentinel begins setting up pillars and it's revealed that he was supposed to meet Megatron here on Earth, but after he went offline, Megatron knew that he had to get Optimus to revive him with the Matrix.
Yeah, except there are 3 problems with that. Seriously, do you even understand the basic concept of continuity?
So Optimus tries to stop Sentinel, but is too late as he activates the pillar, reviving all the dead Transformers on the moon and forcing the Autobots to retreat. Sam then goes to confront Gold, and after revealing that he's working for the Decepticons, shocker, I know, he takes Carly hostage and demands Sam spy on the Autobots for him. Meanwhile, the UN gets a message from Sentinel asking the Autobots to be exiled in exchange for the safety of their planet, an obvious trap that they stupidly walk into. So Sam tries to get some last-minute intel from Optimus as the Autobots leave, but instead gets a motivational speech about the importance of friendship and faith in the heart of the courage or something like that, before he boards the ship. The next day, shortly after liftoff, Starscream proceeds to blow the ship up, leaving the Earth completely defenseless.
But seeing as there's still about an hour left in the movie, this scene really has no tension to it.
So through some weird techno crap, Dutch is able to trace Gold's phone to Chicago, leading Sam and Epps to enlist a group of retired Nest soldiers to go kick some ass. Back to Chicago, Gold reveals that the Decepticons plan on moving Cybertron here and enslaving the human race to help rebuild it, before cutting to even more trailer-style editing as the Decepticons begin to blow up Chicago. We then get a montage of Nest gearing up for war and arriving in Chicago, only to instantly get attacked by a Decepticon. Luckily, they're saved by...
we will kill them all.
Optimus then reveals that he somehow tricked the planet into thinking that they were all dead to prove just how much the Earth needed them.
He's an asshole.
So the team storms Chicago, Sentinel relieves Megatron of his command, and Sam and Bumblebee are able to save Carly from Gold, killing Laserbeak in the process. Unfortunately, the Autobot's cover is blown in the process, and the Decepticons attack while Sam uses a downed UAV drone to signal the rest of Nest, as the movie's final battle is about to begin with an Autobot named Q giving everyone special weapons called Boomsticks.
You know, that just makes me want to watch Army of Darkness instead.
While trying to escape Shockwave, Sam and Carly are separated from Epps and the rest of his mercenaries, and are cornered by Starscream as the battle nobody has been waiting for is about to begin.
Ah!
gotta be kidding me. Well, they did it. They jumped the shark, nuked the fridge, fried the goddamn Coke. Sam Witwicky has just killed Starscream.
No. No. Mm-mm. Mm-mm. No. 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 Hell no. 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 I refuse. No. No.
After that piece of freeze-dried horse crap, we get something even more insulting.
You simply fail to understand that the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few.
That's right. Michael Bay can now add Trekkies to the list of people he's insulted.
So after yet another boot to the balls by Bay, Sentinel activates the teleporter as Dutch is able to lower the bridge, allowing Ness to enter the city, as Gold decides to solidify how big a douche he is by ordering Soundwave to execute the prisoners, starting with Q.
No. Okay, you get it. I really don't give a shit.
He's just about to kill Bumblebee as well, but he's saved thanks to a distraction from Wheeling and Brains, and joins Nesta and the rest of the Autobots in fighting the Decepticons. While this is going on, Optimus shoots the main pillar, stopping the teleporter and forcing Sentinel to enter the fray himself, while Sam and Gold, noticing the teleporter isn't destroyed, goes off to fix/finish the job. Unfortunately, Gold is able to reactivate it.
Despite Sentinel saying earlier that he was the only one able to control the pillars.
Just as Carly convinces Megatron to join in the battle by calling him
nothing but Sentinel's bitch.
And just as Optimus gets his arm torn off by Sentinel, he enters the fray as we cut back to Sam throwing Gold into the pillar, killing him before Bumblebee spears the pillar, destroying it.
And a spear! The second of the night for Edge, one against Jericho!
This in turn deactivates all the Decepticon airships, transports them back to the moon, and destroys the remains of Cybertron as we cut back to Optimus, Sentinel, and Megatron, as the battle everyone has been waiting for.
Is over in less than a minute. This movie's balls!
While the writing is definitely a step up from the last movie, it's still really insulting to our intelligence, with several scenes that completely contradict what happened in the other movies. Plus, the scenes with Sam or the rest of the humans just seem to drag on and on.
I kid you not, it took me 3 tries to get through this movie, and even then it was a pain in the ass to do so.
Add in the lack of proper payoff, and this movie really has only 2 things going for it.
As I mentioned before, the plot twist with Sentinel Prime working for Megatron the whole time was bloody brilliant. The tension had me on the edge of my seat the entire sequence.
The only other good thing about this movie were the performances of Frances McDormand as Charlotte Meering, Peter Cullen as Optimus, Leonard Nimoy as Sentinel, and Alan Tudyk as Dutch, as they seem to be the only people who made any attempt to own their roles. The only other good actors barely got enough screen time to make much of an impact performance-wise.
Everything else about this movie really falls short, especially in the soundtrack department.
The soundtrack here, while containing music from artists I thoroughly enjoy listening to, like Paramore, Taking Back Sunday, and of course, Linkin Park, was kind of a letdown. The lead single, Iridescent, by Linkin Park seemed shoehorned in, and the only songs here that remotely seemed to fit with the story were Faith by Taking Back Sunday and Monster by Paramore, neither of which were really used to promote the movie.
All in all, while I don't think this is the worst of the 3, I also really don't think it's the best of them either. Sadly, that title still goes to the original, because it's the least insulting, the least annoying, and the lack of Transformers makes sense. Now for the first half, at least. So until next time, I'm the... Look, I took a look at your stupid trilogy, will you just leave me alone?
Oh, but Critic, we were having so much fun. I could show you my other remakes, like A Nightmare on Elm Street, or even Friday the 13th.
Yeah, I don't think so.
Or maybe I'll force you to watch my Ninja Turtles remake when it comes out. You know, the one with all the aliens. I have so many changes in mind for that. First of all, April O'Neil's gonna be a stripper, right? So I figured—
That's it! You cocky cock! You will pay for your crimes against humanity! Create card!
What are you doing, Critic?
Oh, it's quite simple. I created a wormhole to allow me to do this.
Why are you holding a pink trading card?
It's not pink. It's fighting salmon. Illusion
really,
card.
Critic.
Show
I
Michael Bay
how
he fears the
paper
most.
Could... No. There's no explosions. No scantily clad women. How can someone make a successful movie without those things? No. No! No!
Sweet coins! Only $2.35? Rip-off! Oh well, until next time, I'm the Hipster Ninja, saving fandoms one bad adaptation at a time. Cheap-ass hop goblins. But when I